Good morning, everyone. My name is Jack Gershfeld, and I'm going to be talking about AVSnap today. We have a very special program today. We're going to go over a different technique called the rat nest design, and we're going to use AVSnap to show how this is done. So this is what I call rapid or fast design using AVSnap. So let's go ahead and start by changing the page size, and I'm going to need about 17 by 11 right now. And you can see I'm using scale 1:1. So what we're going to do, we're going to design a home theater today from scratch and see how fast we can do it. We have about 50 minutes and see if we can complete the full design in 50 minutes. It's a little bit ambitious, but it gives us a great opportunity to see how fast things can be done in AVSnap. And I call this design type rat nest design. That means we don't care about the lines, how straight they are. We just start designing, because you may have something in your mind and you may have some layout in your mind, so you just start from there. So I'm going to start from the left-hand side because I know I'm going to have a little place, projector place where I'm going to put a projector, so I'll make a little square for the projector. I also know that I'm going to have some kind of rack or maybe enclosure where I'm going to keep the rest of the stuff, so I'm going to just put enclosure in here. Then I'm going to allocate some space where I'm going to have my projector, so the projector screen. So my projector screen and associated equipment will be someplace here. And I also want to put in the same home theater room, I want to put a television on the side where it can be folded out 90 degrees and then pushed back into the wall. So if you just want to watch TV during the day, pull the TV out, and if you want to watch the movie, then you go to the screen. So what I've done right now, I've created a four distinct areas, and I'm just going to work in each area separately and then reconnect them together and see how that's going to work for me, okay? So the first thing I'm going to do, I'm going to create a little symbol and say I want to be able to go to the Internet. I want to be able to connect and control the system to the Internet. So I'm going to double-click on a round object, and then we're going to say Internet. But then I need to make it look like Internet. So let's go ahead and zoom the image in. So I'm going to press B for properties, and right here we have a cloud shape. So I'm going to click cloud shape. Apply, and there's my cloud shape internet, okay? So when this is done, I know I'm connected. I'm going to have a cable box. So the cable box is going to go right here. That's in my rack. So I'm going to put cable box. And then I'm going to move in and create a little round symbol for power, because I know I'm going to need power. So I'm going to just put it in here. And what I like to do when I do this, I'm just going to make it yellow color. And it stays distinct, and I know how many powers I'm going to need. So I'm going to just put the power right next to it. That's my cable box. And then I'm going to continue with my projector here on the side. This is my projector. See, I'm just using symbols very quickly to say the projector. Double-click projector. And the system is coming alive slowly. Increase it a little bit, make it a little bit smaller here. I'm going to need to get the signal to the projector, so I'm going to use some kind of transmitter. I'm definitely going to need the power for the projector, so here comes the power outlet. And I'm going to need to power some kind of transmitter. Typically, it's HD based T or some kind of device to transmit the signal. So I'm going to double-click and put here HD based T, or you can do anything else that you're comfortable with. So, and that will require power, unless you have power over Cat5, which is okay. And immediately I'm going to draw the cable to the right and type key K shortcut, and I put HDMI. So that gives me a quick idea that, and pressing the arrow to the right, right above the period, pressing that rectangle bracket, I can go ahead and actually display HDMI right here in the cable. So when I print it out, it's all going to be nice and neat, okay? So I'm going to click on the empty space on the page, and I'm going to set default text size to 10 or 11, so it's a little bit easier for me to see. Press F button to fit everything in. And finally, I'm going to need RS-232 to control the projector, so I'm going to take one more line, and I'm going to connect it from here to here, And I'm going to type in, it's bidirectional, so I'm going to put two arrows on each side, one on the left and the right, and I'm using it by pressing comma and a period, or a little rectangular bracket. Press K button and type in RS-232. And now display that information here, and we're all set. There's the rest of 32 here, HDMI, we're pretty much set. And I also need to know what cable I'm going to use. So I'm going to just draw the cable from here. I don't know where it's going to go, but I'm just going to draw the cable, press K, and I'm going to put UTP, unshield the twisted pairs. And I'm going to put UTP1, and I'll tell you the reason is because I'm going to copy-paste this cable, and it will automatically go UTP1, UTP2, UTP3. So this way, I'm automatically going to be labeling cables at the same time. So when I go to the material list or cable list, I will see right away, you know, what cable I'm going to have. This one I have UTP1, so I'll have all the labeling available for me. All right, so I'm finished up with my projector. I can control the projector. I can also send the video signal, but I also like to run extra cables just in case. And the reason is this particular projector, I'm going to use Panasonic for this design. It has the trigger point, so when you turn the projector on, it triggers, and I want that feedback. So I'm just going to go ahead and put the extra cable here. And you can see it automatically was renamed to UTP2. So now I have two cables here. So let's move on through our design, and I'm going to have a cable box, and the cable box will be connected to the internet. Okay, so that's going to give me my HDMI signal. Okay, I'm going to also have a cable modem, and that will give me my network. Okay, so I'm going to put cable modem. Sometimes it's the same, sometimes it's separate, but I'm just going to go ahead and connect it to here, just to give me an idea where it is, okay? The next thing we're going to do is to put an IP switch, and I usually put, I don't care how many ports, I just put IP switch, and then I add number of ports I need. And as you can see, our design is slowly taking shape. There's my IP switch, and I'm going to also going to need the control PC, or I usually use a netbook PC. It's small, it costs under $200, and you can't beat it. You can put the control software on it, and you can stream the software over the iPad if you want to control it, or any other wireless device, or you can just control it with a touch screen. And then, of course, I'm going to go through my normal stuff, and I'm going to put power connectors here, so this later on I know exactly how many outlets I'm going to need. And right here, my PC. So that one will connect through the network to my IP switch. There's another network that's going to go from here to here. And there's my IP switch. And you can put little arrows here. You can see I quickly can put the arrows in. And then I'm going to also have probably Amazon TV connected to the device. So I'm going to put Amazon. Now some of the TVs are already smart TVs. So, which is okay. If they're smart TVs, then you don't need Amazon. And finally, I'm going to come back here, and I'm going to put, let's put audio receiver, audio-video receiver. Now, notice that I just typed it in. If it needs to be, it automatically formats it if I need to make changes or anything else, okay? So there's my receiver. That's going to be the little hub where I'm going to switch everything, audio, video, and I'm going to run all my speakers. And I'm going to go ahead now and put a controller. I need a small controller that will give me some relays, some RS-232, some IR if I need to. So I'm going to pick up a Neutron controller. We happen to make this controller. And I don't know what size I'm going to have. We have two sizes. But I'm just going to put here because I need it, and later on I'll figure out what size it is. Okay. Cable, take a look at it. We're in UTP3 now. Copy, paste. There's more UTP cables coming in. And now we remember we have this contact closures from projector triggers. I'm going to go ahead and just move them right to the controller. Okay, right there. Because I have relays there, so I'm just, if I want to move it a little bit around, I'll just kind of swing it a little bit on the side, and it just keeps moving, all right? Let's continue with this. The next thing I'm going to do is to take a Cat 6 right here, and I know that I'm going to need HD base T transmitter. So I'm just going to copy-paste this guy, put it here, HD base T, put here TX, and I'm going to run the TX cables all the way through here. Now notice I'm using a rat nest. I'm really, the whole design, I'm just laying things out. I don't care whether they're straight or not. I'm just connecting things together. I need to understand how things are going to flow. So in HD base T, I'm going to take the output from here, connect it to here. That's my output. And, of course, I'm going to make it HDMI cable. If you want to go a little bit slower, you can, of course, put the cable length that you think you're going to need. This is going to be in the rack, so about 6 feet will be just fine. Okay. And what I noticed that, okay, I have HD base T, but I also have this television, so I'm probably going to need to put some kind of a distribution amplifier or something to give me two outputs. Now, some of the video receivers, audio-video receivers, have two outputs, so you can use this for two different zones. Or you can just copy-paste and put another 1x2 DA, and later on decide how you want to handle it. All right, this goes back into here. Output from here goes to two transmitters. And one of them goes here, and the other one, UTP, I'm just going to copy-paste from this guy, and that goes to television. So let's bring our television in here. There's a television. I'm going to draw a TV on the swing. Here's my TV. I'm going to need a power connector here. All right, I'm going to put to my HD base T receiver, RX. And now that it's connected, and finally, I'm going to put cable here, which is going to be my HDMI cable. All right. Pressing Y already builds up all the cables for me. I can see how many HDMI cables I'm going to need. I can see how many UTP cables I'm going to need. I can see how many RS-232 cables I'm going to need. So as we're doing this, we're building up the system of what we're going to do. Now, as a backup, I'm going to go ahead and copy, put here infrared remote control. Maybe the system goes off or something off. You still want to turn the projector and everything else. You have a little remote control here. Now, we're not done here yet. From Amazon TV, I'm going to run another. So that's a Y cable. Okay, let's see what it is. HDMI. Good. So I'm going to just going to paste it and run one from Amazon TV. Okay. From the cable box, I'm going to run another cable. There's a cable box input right here. And then we are done with the video, except we need to now have a little bit more control. So on the audio receiver, I'm going to have some speakers. So let's go ahead and position some speakers. I need a couple of on the back. I need three in the front, so we're going to use a surround system. So I'm going to go ahead and add the speaker here. And I'm going to say subwoofer. That's going to go here on the side. There's my subwoofer, and I like to make the subwoofers green. That's a little bit too much green, so let's make it a little bit lighter. So it's got this. There we go. Subwoofer. And now I'm just going to copy-paste and say SP left. A little bit smaller. In this case, probably I'm going to mount them above the projector pointing down, so we're going to come back here. It's going to be SP center and SP right. And then we're going to come back here and say copy paste and move two of them in the back someplace here. And we're going to put speaker left right. Okay, so now we have our six speakers and we need to use a speaker wire. So I'm going to go ahead and create another cable here. Press K. And I'll put here SP-1. That's going to give me speaker wire 1. And then I'm just going to go like this. what I'm doing, I'm copy-pasting it, and if I press property on it, you can see it's already speaker 4. And so I don't need to renumber them. Everything is here. Tell me exactly what we're going to have. And finally, I'm going to connect it to here. So there is our design coming very, very well. Neutron controller, so I'm going to control the audio-video receiver. So I'm going to control it using RS-232. So I'm just going to copy cable that already has RS-232. If I need to delete the band, I'll delete the band. And there's my neutron controller controlling RS-232. Cable box is coming in. And then we need to control the screen. So here, I'm going to have a couple of things. I'm going to have the blinds that come out and cover. So there's my blinds. And in this case, particular case, I have a window behind me, so I need to have blinds, and then I'm going to have a ceiling screen that's coming down, okay? So let's copy a couple of more power connections here. So I need a power in here. Let's see if I need power anywhere else. Neutron controller needs a power, and then the receiver needs a power, and then we have a couple of powers here. So there we go. Finally, we have a couple of more Cat5 cables. We're going to run into here on the right-hand side. And let's see. I have a question here. Okay. So let's go ahead. Somebody was asking if I can demonstrate the clone. So let's go ahead and see if I can remove this cable and do the clone really quick. So I select the cable. Or right here, there's a clone tool. Just select this, and when you click on the cable, you just drag it out. And it will, as you keep dragging it, it creates new cables for you. So just bring it in and connect. It's exactly the same as copy-paste, except it allows you to just drag the items. Once you select it, you can just keep dragging the items. So now I'm not in clone mode, but if I would click a clone button, and I want a speaker left, I just drag it out. I just click and drag it. And you can see the clone tool has a little two items like it's cloning it. So you just drag this out, okay? And then when you finish with it, just click it, and now I'm going to delete it. So it's exactly the same as copy-paste. But there's a couple of things that you can do with the clone. So I'm going to copy this, and I'm going to say, okay, right-click. And you see you have also repeat functions. So in the repeat function, it's very interesting because you can go left and right repeat, and you can do the spacing. So I'm going to go repeat right, times to repeat, let's say I'm going to put 5, spacing between, okay, I'm going to put 0.1 inch, and direction 90 degrees. So when I go here, it gives me an array of 5 items. So you can go different ways on repeat or clone or copy-paste, okay? All right, so we are almost there with the design, and we're in 17 minutes flat. We're almost done with the design, okay? So let's go ahead and bring a couple of more CAT cables because we need to control them. CAT cables will come from a neutron controller because that's going to give us another RS-232, but the contact closures. So we're going to move one into here, and let's go ahead and just bring it on top here. Okay, so there's our one control. And then we do copy paste, bring it up here, and we have a control now for our shade to close. So we pretty much have everything that we need to do. So I'm going to come back here and just make a little note for myself that this is the drop down screen. And in this case, I'm probably going to be using screen innovations because I have lots of light in the room. And I want to make sure that I have good ambient light reflection. And then I have shades. Okay, that will give me this. And, of course, you can add here the if you need to have a stand or anything else. Pretty much at this point, I have my system. I know how things are connected. I know things, how they're going. So I'm going to save it right at this point. And I'm going to add another page, okay? Another page, duplicate. And I do duplicate all the copy objects, okay? So I'm going to create exactly the same page, and I'll explain it to you in a second, okay? So now you have two pages, one page that has just a rat nest, and that's what I call rat nest. It's a configuration where you don't really care about how the cables are laid out. You're just doing the rat nest. So the next thing I need to do, I need to tell installers, put the cables in, Okay. Because a lot of times they're in the rough production, they have rough walls set up, the drywalls are not put in. So we just want to tell them, run all the cables. Here are the cable layouts. So I'm going to go to page number 2. And I'm going to now use this page and create the final layout, okay? So let's go ahead and delete everything that I have inside the cabinet, okay? We don't need it, except the cables. You see, I don't need all of this. I just need to know what cable is coming into the box, okay? So I'm going to go ahead and delete this. So there is my setup currently, okay? Now, we can see that I don't need really anything on the inside either. Okay, so I'm going to go ahead, and I can create later, I'm going to create electrical diagram. And so I just need a projector. So let's go ahead and move everything back and make it a little bit smaller so that I can give the diagram. Okay, the projector goes into here. There's my projector. Now, by the way, if you want to scale something, one way to scale it is to select all the objects and then press letter X. Letter X allows you to group objects together. Okay, that's a group. But once you group it, look, you can scale it up and down. It will scale the text. It will scale everything in it. And then once you get to the right size scaling, you just press X again, and there are again separate items. So now that I scale it here, and these are the cables that I'm going to need. So I'm going to bring the cable here, and now I'm going to turn my draw assist on. So I turn the draw assist on, so when I draw this, it will just snap to the right places. Okay. I'm also going to enable, if you go to the properties, I'm going to go ahead and enable the show net names so that I can see the net names on each side. So in this case, it's UTP1, and I'm just going to bring it right here. There's my cable, okay? I don't need this right now, so that goes away. This goes away. So definitely I'm going to need speakers coming in here, so I'm going to leave the speaker on, bring it in here, and basically align the speakers. So this is the time that I want to define the colors. So in this case, I'm going to use a dot to dot. So I'm going to go on the bottom, which says number 2 solid. I'm going to click dash and dot. So you can see there's my dot. And I'm probably going to want to make it red line colors. So now I know that this is my speaker wire. Click on it, go to properties, and go ahead and enable net on both sides, okay? So there's my speaker. So now when I run the cable, I always enable the net so I can see what's connected to what, all right? Now this one is another Cat5 cable, so I'm going to just come back here and enable the nets. It's UTP2, and I'm just going to position and run it right through here. And you see the draw assist allows me just to run it really quickly, and I put arrows to the right. Okay, there we go. So now I have 2 UTP1s. I have speaker wire here. I also need a speaker wire to go here, so I'm just going to come back and do a little adjustment here, and the speaker wire is going to go right here. Now, the only difference on this speaker wire, that's the wrong color and everything is not the same as I have for the other wire, which is okay. We have a function. It's called the copy properties. Okay, so I'm going to click on this object. I'm going to right-click on it and say copy properties. Okay, so I'm only copying properties. Right click on this and I say paste properties. And you can see now it's identical. The formatting the same, the color the same, even it displays the net names. Okay, so far so good. I got this side done. So the next side is I have a speaker subwoofer that's going to go right into here. I have a speaker left, so that's going to go here. And we'll align the cables nicely. And then I have speaker right, center, sorry about this. And what I'm going to do is just to pick up this end, put it someplace here, double click, and finally the speaker. All right. Select both of this, all three of them, right click, and then I say paste properties. And you can see right away they're the same. Now this came out to be different, so copy properties from UTP. select the items from UTP. Right here. And paste property. We're back to normal. So far, so good. And we finally get UTP cables here. So just line them up on the top. Delete, and run it here. Subwoofer can be smaller. And finally, do the same thing here. Delete. All right. And then I can just take it to the center and move it up. So you can see in a very short period of time, I have identified all the cables that I need to run. Okay. And I also have all the nets of the cables and everything that needs to be done right here. All right. So that's a quick and easy design of the system. Now, there's another part of the system which is going to be a control design. In the control design, we're actually designing the control functions of it. But with this, I can give it to a contractor and I can tell him, run me UTP cables. So here's all the UTP 1, 2, 3. They're all labeled. So put the labels in it, put the speaker in it, and I'm ready to go. All right. Now, this is the actual design. It so happened to that I have this design at my home. And so I was able to kind of share it with you. If you look on the right-hand side, I have similar design that I've done for my home, and then the layout was done to show all the key cables, how they need to run, and how the closet is going to go, and so forth. All right. So I hope that kind of gave you a quick idea how to do it very quickly. And we were able to finish right in about 26 minutes. We were able to put the whole system together. Now let's move on. And I want to share with you the control portion of it. How do we do control portion of it? I have a different project that I want to share with you. I'm going to share the control part. It's also done using the rat nest design, okay? So I'm going to go ahead and skip this. This is my design. Just put it on the desktop so I don't lose it. And I'm going to load another one, another design, which is actually now a control design. Now, notice that I also use the same thing for control design as I use for the overall design. So in this case, I start with AVSnap, running Win7 on a PC, IP switch, couple of Neutron controllers, USB touch control, VGA video, touch systems, touch monitor, and then I fan out from the Neutron controller out into different areas. So in this case, I have electrosonic telephone, mixer, telephone, expander, and a Blu-ray, all on COM1 through COM5. I have a relay system that controls AC power to the rack. Then the second Neutron controller has COM1 through 7, RS-232, and through 8, RS-232, and it uses some relays also. I haven't put them yet here. Now, the way that I do this, as I start programming control, I put yellow color on each device that I finish programming. So if I finish programming on this device, that means I can communicate with this, and everything is working, I make it yellow. So in this case, all of these are already finished. This one I finished, but this life-size video conference, that still needs to have some work. And wall display, left table, right table, card is finished here. So it gives me a very quick view. Now what's nice about this, that you have a design, control design, and the actual layout, touchscreen layout, all in the same file. So you don't have a separate document. So from here, I also have the physical layout of how things are going, all the connections between the switchers and the amplifiers and audio, a little template for user interface, and of course the next is the application object. In this case, I have a couple of three timers. I have a TCP Neutron 1. I have Neutron 2 TCP control. And so for each Neutron, I have one TCP control. So one is on port 80, one is on port 81. So as you can see, starting from here, this is all design features of the project. And on the left-hand side, these are all user interface. everything located in the same file, so you never have to worry about missing one versus the other. Okay, so in this case, if I have interface and interface, you can see I have lots of things on the side, but when you actually display, you can only see this, and I utilize also lots of layers. So you can see different layers will give me different screens and different buttons. Okay, and when you unclick the layer, you can see the composite video. So even though I have pages, but each page has maybe 6 or 7 layers of different information, so that allows you quickly switch between different screens. If you need an audio control, for example, I have a mixture here, so the mixer will work right from here, and you can mix everything and put together. And then if you need a telephone control, you can dial the telephone will show up here, and you can list the directory. So if you want to list the directory, you go into the directory area, and it's a single push button. And if you need more information, you can go to a full directory of all the people who are going to be using the system, and you can just click on that, and it will automatically dial the phone number. And there's some timers set up here if you want to start reset timers. If the judge needs attention, you put judge attention. And then confirm shutdown, and when we go to screensaver, we get a black screen. And then I have a page called test. And in the test, I add the buttons that I'm going to be using for testing the system. Because it's one thing that you set up the system, but a lot of times it's for troubleshooting. So I add all the kind of buttons here that do things that are not needed for normal application, but they allow me to test, switching inputs, creating the tone generator, turning on, setting different gains, power things in. And I also use it to test RS-232 codes, TCP/IP codes, and everything else, okay? But what's important that you can combine all of this in one file. Now, AVSnap also has a multi-view, okay, multiple page view, so you can just click like this, zoom out, and you can see this is my full project. I have user interface from left to right, and I have my layouts on the bottom, and the templates also on the bottom, okay? And then, so it gives you a good overview of the overall project. All right, that kind of puts together a quick overview of how we take the project, design it. All right, somebody says do that again, and I'm assuming do that again means a multi-view. Now, remember, if you double-click on any of these, of course, you're going to go to a full project, okay? So right here on the top, right next to the zoom factor, there's a fit page, there's a fit object, and there's a multiple page view. So when you click on multiple page view, you see all the pages. You can zoom in, okay, or you can zoom out on these pages if you want, or you can double-click and go to a specific page that you want. Now, if you want to do shortcuts, which everybody likes shortcuts, so if I double-click here, if I zoom out and press F, it fits at the screen. If you press Alternate F, so Alternate key right next to the Windows key, Alternate F, it gives you automatically that view. So you don't need to push any buttons. Just use your left key. That's why you probably missed it the first time. Okay, and then press F again. It returns back to the page you were in. Okay. All right, so that gives us that feature. Let's go ahead and do a couple of other things. Let's go ahead and enable the server and see if we can just run the system in the server and use it to iPad or iPhone to control it. So I'm going to go ahead and go to Run, and I'm going to go to Server Settings, okay? In the Server Settings, I'm going to enable the server, okay? So let's go ahead and enable it. Now, because port 80 is your port for internet, you don't want to use port 80. But you can use port 81 or any other ports that are available, okay? Default page is home page, and if you're missing a page, it will go to 404 to home page, and error page is also home page. Picture quality, I usually drop to about 90%. You can drop it about 80% and improve performance and not see that much difference, especially on the small devices. You can also specify secure pages if you want pages to be secure. That means non-repetitive. That means when you display them in the browser, they're not going to be visible as pages that you can just remember URL and go to the same page. Display graphical user interface, that means you're going to display graphical user interface on your screen while somebody else is using the browser. Or you can just hide it in the bar, in the toolbar, and you never see it, okay? I like to send buttons as pictures instead of using the native HTML5 button renderings. And I like to send text of the pictures also. Then you know that nobody worries about the font. Everybody's set perfectly. And center pages horizontally. And I like to compress images to PNG, okay? And pretty much you need to use 24-bit, unless you make black and white or limited colors. If you use 8-bit, it's just going to look bad. You can also add your own logo, and that's a logo that will show up in the top left corner of the browser, and I'll show that. Minimize time, 10 seconds. That's for the display. I'll show you that. And page transition, I like to use a blend. That's my favorite, 0.1 second, so it's nice and smooth. The web browser server uses the AJAX capability. It basically allows you to minimize refresh cycles as you click through the buttons. Do not disable it. If you want to disable it, that will refresh page every time you press the button, and then you press OK. So we can now theoretically press F9, and it tells you that the web server is enabled. Okay. So we're going to say OK. We're going to wait until the system powers up. Now, in this system, it's initializing. Now, I don't have the control connected to it, so it's initialized on the bottom, but every connection is trying to make it, probably failing, so that's why it's taking a little bit longer to do this. But you can see that, let me just go ahead and open this control system. You can see, good. So there's the system, and it's running. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to go ahead and go to the browser, and in this case, I'm going to go to the browser that says unable to connect. 192.168.1.127. That's my personal fixed IP on my computer, and I use port 81. Okay. As you can see, the page displayed this. So when I press system on the browser, it's automatically started the system. And now it's initializing this. Once initialized, it will update it here also. But you can see that they're now tied together on your devices. Now, you can, of course, you can put a GIF or anything else that plays around when you, while you're waiting for the system to initialize. So it doesn't have to be this way. Also, it's designed for a screen, not for web browser. For web browser, you probably would limit the size. You would probably do something like 640 by 480 or maybe 1024 by 768. But that's probably as much as you would go because you don't want it to go too large so you don't have to scroll. So you can see now that it's updated. You're in full mode and both in control. If you mute here, it mutes here. So there's our browser. There's our icon. You see right here on the right-hand side, there's our icon on the left-hand side that will show up. And you can put your own icon. The control system, that's a page name that you're going to be using. So you can change name of your actual file. I'm sorry, that's a file name. And then the page name is right here. So this is audio HTML. But in reality, that's an audio page, okay? If you wanted to phone conference, then it's going to go telephone HTML, okay? When you put secure pages, then it will obliterate all of this and just put some random number that will vary from every time you start the system, so nobody can actually save it as a shortcut and go to the same page. I mean, of course, you can save each page as a shortcut and go to, but that's basically your interface. Okay, and that's how you connect. Now, this particular feature, it needs to be enabled, and to be enabled, you go to the Enable Software Protection, okay? So right here, you have two things you can enable. You can enable the web server that we just did, and we also can enable this software protection. The software protection means that you can, once you lock it, it will only run on one computer. So when you supply it to a customer, you want to make sure that the system is not copy-pasted to many other computers. You just get a registration key from us, and once you register to that a MAC address right here, then you will know for sure that nobody can take it from, if they take it to a different system, it's just not going to work. Okay. All right. We are moving forward. Let's go ahead and clear this up. And we're going to go to a new mode of operation because this is a full design. So let's go ahead and close a couple of things here. Okay. Closing them on my side. The web browser is closed. Everything is closed. So what I'm going to do right now, I'm going to print this as a PDF file, okay? And the reason is I want to show you something, how to print it in a PDF file. And then what we can do with PDF. So PDF Creator, I have this program, PDF Creator, and I'm going to print all the pages. You can scroll all the pages and you kind of see how the pages show up there. And I'm going to sit to page, and I'm going to just go ahead and print it. It's taking a little time. There's the file, and this is my system. And it automatically goes to my folder. I already have the folder, so I'm just going to save to that folder. And in this case, let's go to the desktop. All right. Now when it's done, it's printed one page only because I probably did something. Oh, it says current page. I need to say all pages, apply, and print all pages. That will make it easier. Save my design system PDF and save yes. I want to replace it, and there we go. So now it's printed everything that I have there. So I'm going to go ahead and close it, and then I'm going to figure out what am I doing with all of this. So let's see. That's my system. AVSnap 6.0.1 now has a feature that will manage PDF files. So I'm going to just drop this PDF file right in here. And you can see once you drop the file in, it shows the file on the left-hand side. Okay. And you can just scroll down through all the pages that you have here. You can open any PDF file, but what's nice, you can now move pages and relocate them anywhere you want. Okay, so you can double-click on it to get full page, or you can zoom out, double-click again to get back to this view. You can also move pages around. If I want to move this page in the front, I just move it to the front. If you move this page to here, I can move. So you can rearrange the pages. You can also insert a blank page in between. If you want to demarcate or segregate something, you can say main design, something like this. And in this case, I'm going to do landscape, and you can also do the background of the page, and you can say, okay, add background of the text. And then now you added the empty page in between. Now, if you don't like this empty page, just press delete, and the page will be gone. Now, notice you also have an empty pane on the right-hand side. Well, you can open two files at the same time, or you can drag the pages to this pane if you want to separate them or combine them, whatever you need to do. So now you can save this file separately on the right-hand side, and you can also save the file on the left-hand side separately. So they're now two independent files. You can see this is my system PDF, and this is untitled PDF page one out of four. Okay. So what it does, it allows you to take any PDF file and just kind of strip it, clean it around, move it, and recreate the format. Or if you have multiple pages on different projects, you can combine it into a single file. So you can definitely select multiple pages and then move multiple pages all at once to the left or to the right. You see. So that's another feature that was added to AVSnap. And finally, I think I have one person who is joining us who needed the volume control and microphone control. So we went ahead and added this capability to the unit. So I'm going to go here and show you how you control volume and microphone using AVSnap for your computer. So here are the two controls that I put here in a little sample. And if you right-click on the control and show the code on change, you can see that the application app.setVolume and then the slider position will adjust the volume on your computer. Now, the other one is microphone volume. So now you can have full control over volume on your computer with this version. Now, the last question is that people are asking me a lot is, when is the 6.0 version going to be available? And I need to apologize for delaying it. We have to make sure that it's compatible to the previous versions, and that's what takes the longest time, is to reload the old versions. We have some test files that we use to test all the versions, and then make sure that whatever changes we made in 6.0 or files created in 6.0 are backwards compatible all the way to 5.0, and files from 4.0 and up are compatible with 6.0. And that's been taking a long time, more time than I wanted. And just this morning we found small problems, so we started again adjusting it a little bit. But I assure you that this week is the last thing we're going to do, and the last changes we're going to do, and we're going to release it, and you will have it. Because as one friend of mine told me, it's time to kill engineers and go into production. So we're going to stop engineering and release this. So here's a basic overview of how to speed design your project. We have volume control and microphone control. We have a new tool which is called the PDF Manager, and it manages PDF. It's right here. There's an icon. It's called Display PDF Tool. It has limited functions right now. You can move the pages, add the pages, subtract the pages, delete the pages. But we've had many other requests of actually allow quick modification of the pages. You can also use any page from the PDF file to set as a background for AVSnap drawings, so that's also available. So there's lots of things you're going to like. But this is a new tool, and we're going to improve it as we go forward. We're going to add additional features. RatNest control for control and RatNest for design, that's kind of a new introduction. I'm not sure if anybody ever used this type of design. I've used it for many, many years, and it works really nice. And you can clean it up later, but at least it gives you a quick view of the design. And on that, we are 10 minutes into the end. And if you have any questions, let me go ahead and adjust so that we can get people unmuted here.
All attendees are muted and may unmute themselves by pressing star 6.
Okay. And I'm going to go back, and I'm going to display the screen. So if you have any questions, feel free to ask. But that's kind of an overview of the AVSnap and final design features. Okay, so I'm going to go ahead and turn it off while we're talking about this, and give you a couple of other features while we discussing. When you come up with the questions, I'm all here. You can unmute yourself and then just ask the question. Okay. I see I have a couple of comments that everybody likes the PDF tool. That's great. So let's go ahead and go to the page number 8.5 by 11, and I want to show you. Yeah, because control mode, it cannot switch. So let's go ahead and new project. And I'm going to show you a couple of more features on the page setup. On the page setup, you know that we have a zoom. And when you enable the grid, you will see the grid as gray lines. Okay. You can also change them to dots. And I've had many people ask for it. And you can also make them to go on top. So if you have lines, and you go on top. So now if you draw the object, and even if you fill it with some color, you can see that the lines will be drawn still on top. So if you need to align something, you're not going to lose the lines, okay? The other thing is, many times you will create a template which has all the pages already pre-assigned for the project, and you may want to put it in the library and make it available to everybody. Then right here, you can set up a default project. A default project means that every time AVSnap opens, you will automatically load this project. And I do it quite a bit when I do the project design, because I know I'm always going to have 5 pages, and I know what pages I need. I need audio, video, control, template, and object. So I just put the project here, and then every time I open AVSnap, it opens up the project right away. The other feature, which is really neat, if you have multiple pages, add new pages. And let's say you created this page and accidentally you create many pages of different sizes, okay? And at some point you want to come back and make them all the same. So what you would do, double click on here, select the page you like, and then apply to all pages. And all pages will be adjusted to the same format, okay? They will be adjusted and lined up, so you don't have to go to each individual page and change this. The other thing which is important is a list of fonts used in your project. I've seen many times when people use different fonts, and when they send the project to somebody else, and if they don't have this font, then the picture things don't look right. Or especially if you do control system design, and you put all the buttons with text, and then when you go move it to actual PC, it doesn't have that font. So at least here you have the name of the fonts listed, and once you see this, you can apply those. You can make sure that the computer that you're going to move the project to has the same fonts available. Okay. Now, right here is the important portion. If you're designing and you're making less than 10 pages projects, you can make it much faster if you select fast page change, maximum 10 pages. So sometimes if you have a large project, it may take a little time between the page changes. But once you select this on a smaller project, it will cache all the pages into the memory, and it will switch in much, much faster. The next feature is a show cursor lines. And some people like it, some people don't, but you can change this by hitting a little tilde on a keyboard that's next to the number one on the left-hand side. So you can enable or disable so you have the full cursor across the whole screen, okay? So a couple of more features. You can select object by lines, or you can select object being inside the object, okay? So right now, if I take this object and I draw it, it's an empty object, okay? So I'm going to make it empty on the inside, fill. So you can see when I click on the inside, I cannot select it anymore. I can only select it by lines, but I don't select inside. Why do you want to do this? Well, because if you have outline and you want to work with something on the inside of this, you don't want to accidentally select the outer object. On the other hand, you may select it by the object by being inside that object, regardless whether it's full or empty with the color. Now, if you fill it with color, it doesn't matter. Once you see the color, then it's you're always going to be selected when you click on it, okay? And that particular feature is going to be disabled, so select by lines, okay? The rest of it is... Basically explains to you how you want to set up your working environment. For example, minimum draw size objects. It says 4 pixels. So let's say if I put 20 pixels, apply. So you can see as I zoom out, the one of the rectangles disappeared because it becomes less than 20 pixels. So it basically allows you to make pictures less cluttered as you zoom out, and you have more information as you zoom in, okay? Template, we're familiar. And then you have lots of global features. And the global features are basically if you want to compress project file. As you load different images, you probably want to compress. And if you don't put it as fast as like this, and it will compress it less. Default is kind of medium between compressing and not compressing. And maximum compression, it makes it a little bit slower when you save the file, but creates a maximum file, a minimum file size. And finally, a lot of times bitmap images are very large. So you want to have convert to bitmap images to JPEG. And when you convert it, it's going to become very much smaller, the size. The size of the page is right here on the right-hand side. So you can see on the page on the bottom, you see page size. So if I grab some image and I paste the same rectangle as an image, you can see I just went to 15 kilobytes, right? Now, if I would do the same thing, if I would do the same thing with a bitmap, F6 and capture this. Well, it made a little, if it's more complicated, more colors, you would have significant increase in the size here. So, but if you double click on the global, and they say do not compress bitmap images, okay? Just keep them clean. You can see we went to 1 megabyte if it's not compressed. But if it's compressed, global compressed bitmap images, when you copy paste, you only went to 27 kilobytes. So you do want to keep it compressed to make images smaller and easier. Now, finally, I want to show you a small little feature. If you draw very horizontal lines or you draw circles, you'll see, I'll zoom in for you just a little bit. Let me get the weight a little bit. You see there's a little staircase effect here. And if you're trying to grab the image to show it on your presentation or something, it look kind of ugly. Right here we have anti-aliasing feature, and it smooths things out, okay? See how it smooths this out. Now, I've seen many people work with this feature on, and it makes it a little bit difficult because when you move the object, it turns it off, but then when you release the mouse, it turns it back on. So if you have this type of a problem, just make sure to turn off anti-aliasing. But what I use this for is once I do a design, if I want to present it, I just turn it on, capture my image, and then I turn it off, and then I paste the image to the Word file or something. Now you notice that this image is not very good. So let me see what happened. You gotta be 100% on the settings for image to look the best. Okay, so let's go ahead and do it again. F6. I'm gonna capture the image at 100%. Turn it off. And then I'm going to paste it, and you can see it's nice and smooth edges. All right. Will 6 update be available through the older? Yes. The update 6 will be available through here. It will come up. We do it once a week. So check for updates. If you check for updates, it will show up here and it's going to say new versions available. So right now it says new program version is not available, but we will push it through, and you will get notification on once you run the AVSnap, it will automatically check it once a week, and you will see it. If not, you can just check it here, and it will tell you that something is available. Now, you can click it here and say check for updates every day automatically. That means every time it starts in the morning, first time you run AVSnap, it will check it. So I would turn this on for right now, and as soon as it's available, you will see it coming up. All right, I think we're at the end of the presentation. If you have any questions, please give me a call, or you can send an email at support@altinex.com. As always, I really appreciate that you spend your morning with me for one extra hour, and I'm looking forward to see you next week. As we're coming to the end of our series, we have only a few more webinars left, and have a great rest of the morning. Thank you.